Okay, what's going on, everybody? My name is Mangg. Welcome back to Hanging with Mangg. This is like episode 42 or 3. It's like a crazy number how long we've been doing this already. And we're going to keep doing it because it's cathartic. So we're playing some Bloodborne this time around, and if you are eagle-eyed, you might notice that this is my Drake character from the YOLO, edition. And, yeah, you may be interested in seeing what's going on here, so I'll start with that. Alright, so basically, I did, what was that, Friday, that must have been. I recorded a episode of this, of the YOLO edition with Bloodborne and all that. And, about 26 minutes into the recording, having kicked Amelia's ass, by the way. About 26 minutes in the Forbidden Woods or whatever, my recording program crashed. As it does. And so, I didn't notice until about 3 minutes later when I died. I died to one of those kind of furry guys with the big weapons that just one-hit comboed me. It was ridiculous. So I was like, ah, shit. So, I actually, like, because I had the 26 minutes recorded with all the commentary, so what I did was I went back and I, like, in post-commentary, I kind of recreated what had happened and how I had died. Because it was like a minute, 2 minutes or something. It was like, whatever. So I did that. And I put the video together. It was all good. Well, it wasn't great, but it was all good. And I hit, like, render, and then I left. I went to go do something else, so I left. When I get back, it says, oh, error rendering. I'm like, oh, okay, what's going on? And I find out that, I guess, when Elgato crashes like that, they keep the file temporarily of everything that it had, the 26 minutes. But then they only keep it for, like, 20 minutes. And then they delete it automatically. So it just was irreparably gone with no way for me to save it. So I was just like, well, that's a bust. So that's why you didn't get a video Friday night or whatever. Not much I could do about it. So that's really annoying. But then it's like, okay, so I have this YOLO edition that didn't really end at all. It just kind of petered out. So, there's nothing I could do. There's nothing I could do. I could just have fudged it, I guess, and not told you. But I had already beaten Amelia. Like, I can't beat Amelia again. I'd have to play through the whole game again. Like, no, it's just nothing I could do. So that's why I'm telling you now and whatever. Yeah. So that's a bummer, but it is what it is. I don't know what's up with this Elgato bullshit. It's pissing me off all the time. Yeah. Other than that, what else did we do? We started a Let's Play of Her Story, which is a very unique game. It's been in my mind quite a bit recently after having done that one episode. I got a bunch of comments on that video. People getting into theories and stuff. So we'll be getting back to that probably tomorrow. On Monday, whatever. I'll be recording another episode of that. Very exciting stuff. We did some duelist things. My gauntlet run ended very quickly. Otherwise, I would have had to record it again Saturday. Because the next time the gauntlets open on Wednesday, it'll have been a hard reset, so. Yeah. Yeah, so then, this coming Tuesday, we'll be doing a duelist video. of the hard reset, of me opening packs and hopefully checking out the client, all this new stuff. That'll be good. What else? I didn't really do that much. We did the Mangg cast yesterday. That was good. This week will just be Duelist, her story, and then I guess we have another vacancy because Mangg Souls is done again. I'd really like to finish Axiom Verge. I know very few people have any interest in that, but I have to finish it. It's got to be done. So there will probably be that this week. Zelda's got to happen at some point. Again, very similar to Axiom Verge. Very few people have any interest in that, but I have to record it. Just so history can show that I've played it. What else? Not much. I mean, it is kind of a drought for video games. But that's alright. There's still stuff to play. Maybe Sherlock Holmes, if I get around to it. Although I'm a little nervous after I did the last case with my family. It was rough. So, we'll see. Yeah. Other than that, life goes on. Board games this week, the only thing I really played was on Friday, I went over to Ziggy's house and we played Twilight Struggle, the number one ranked game on Board Game Geek. We finally got around to playing it. It's been sitting on my shelf a little while. Is it my number one game now? Is that what you want to know? Probably you don't care, but I'm going to tell you, it's not my number one game. Does not usurp Cosmic Encounter, but I can recognize how it could be someone's number one game. I think as far as Cold War board games go, it's going to be tough to beat that one. So, if you're a Cold War fan that likes board and card games, it might be your number one. If you're a... I don't even know if I would call it a war game, because it's not a war game, it's a Cold War game, it's different. It's not, I mean, in a way, it's like Risk, in that you're vying for control of areas across the world. You know, you want control of Japan, and of Western Germany, and, Cuba, you know, Mexico, Venezuela, Portugal, the Philippines, you know, all these places are represented, and you want control of everything. You want to control the world, but that's not exactly feasible. And so it's just the mechanics and the theme just blend together so well. Perhaps better than any game I've played before. In that you really kind of feel this tension between you and this other superpower, and you know, it's not like Risk where there's not really any bluffing or hidden agendas or anything like that. It's generally pretty clear cut. There's a lot of kind of secrecy in Twilight Struggle, which I think is why it's so interesting. This whole aspect of... I mean, the game is pretty much card-driven. So, everything is done through playing different cards. Every card's unique, and cards can be used in multiple ways. And so what's interesting is, you might have a hand of cards that's like half good for you, and half good for your opponent. And depending on how you play the card, it might benefit you a little bit, but it might also benefit your opponent. So that's kind of like, oh, I hate to do this for him, but I have to, because your thinking, your strategy, whatever, is that in the end, the benefit for you is hopefully greater. You hope. And then there's also... This is the guy that killed me, by the way. You're hoping that, the way it works is, there's multiple ways to win, but it's not like Civilization or anything. I mean, it's not that varied. Most of the ways you're going to win is either by controlling Europe or victory points. And so the way the scoring works is really interesting. It's not just like at the end of every round, each place is scored. And if you control the majority, you get points. You know, it's not that simple. There's, in the deck of cards, there's a bunch of scoring cards that score different regions. So there's a card that scores Europe. There's a card that scores South America. There's a card that scores Asia. And so you don't know when these cards are going to pop up. And you don't know if your opponent is going to have it or not. And so you might see your opponent start moving aggressively into Asia, where he had prior no interest. And so you're thinking, okay, he probably has the Asia scoring card and he wants to get in there to get some points. But that could just be a bluff to leave you kind of open in other areas where it actually does have, you know, there's that kind of aspect to it, which is really interesting. So yeah, it's definitely a masterfully designed game, no arguments. But it's not my favorite game because, for one, I'm not really a huge history buff. I can appreciate it, but it's not really my thing. Also, it's a bit... It's kind of intense, you know. There's not really much social aspect to it. I mean, it is a two-player game. There aren't many two-player games that have a social aspect to it. But it's a damn good two-player game. But I don't know if a two-player game could ever be my favorite. So I guess a better question is, does it go in my top 10? I'd probably have to play it more than once to decide that. But anyways... So what happened was, I was playing the USSR, Ziggy was playing the US. We didn't really, either of us, know what to do. And so we were kind of just all over the place, spreading around. And I took a very quick early lead in victory points. And it's the way the victory points is interesting, the track. It's not just, it's not a static thing where... Okay, you get 4 points, I get 3 points, you get another 4, I get 5, so now you're at 8, I'm at 8. It's more interesting than that. It's kind of like a rubber band. Like, if you go in one direction, well, I guess, it starts at 0. Okay, and then if I get 4 points, it moves 4 points in the USSR direction. If Ziggy gets 3 points then, it moves down to 1 for USSR, towards the US side. So it's not like ever you're both going to have 10. It's the USSR is going to have 10, and the US has 0, and he's trying to pull it back over to his side. So it's interesting. So I took an early lead, and then I kind of faltered a bit because I just got shitty hands, which can happen, and... I guess if you're a better player, you probably know how to manage a shitty hand, but I didn't. I wasn't. So, I started to lose that lead, and I had zero presence at all in, like, South America and the Middle East, and he had both those scoring cards, and I just didn't. I wasn't observant enough to really catch up on that. So he took a huge score lead then. I think he was... close to winning, but I realized that I had the majority in Europe, and if you control Europe, like, you basically just dominate it completely, and the Europe scoring card is played, that player automatically wins. Just just instantly, because you control Europe, you control the world, I guess. And so the bluff then was, if I had the Europe scoring card on that turn, Ziggy called my bluff, he didn't think I did, so he played elsewhere, and I ended up playing the card and winning. If he did call my bluff and I didn't have the card, and he just worked on Europe, he probably would have won the game that turn through his control in other areas. So, it was lucky I had the card. I mean, that's really just kind of luck of the draw. So, it's not like a deep Euro strategy game with zero luck. I think there is luck involved. But, I mean, most good games do have that. So, I'm amazed I won. It was cool. We only got through like 5 of the 10 rounds, and it took us about 2 hours. But we were both new players, and we were kind of slow, so. But it was very entertaining. I would like to play again. Yeah. The only other board, table, whatever game that I've been playing this week is Infinity. I've also spent a bunch of money on Infinity. I spent like $80 from Warsenal on mostly just markers and tokens for the game. Like high quality acrylic tokens to represent like order markers and templates and, you know, where your grenade goes off, you use a template for how large the radius is and blah, 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 stuff like that. So high quality acrylic, that shit. And then I also managed to get 2 MDF towers with that at a pretty good rate. Unpainted, of course. So they're just kind of wooden towers. Which doesn't really work with the sci-fi theme. You need metal. You need metal or chrome everywhere. And then I also got another paper scenery pack. So right now, Corvus Belli has 2 different prepackaged paper terrain packs. One comes with the Operation Ice Storm. It's like Moto Tyrannica or something like that, which is sort of the Pan-Oceania city. I mean, it's very much just like a sci-fi city type thing, but it's all... it's paper, and it's not very great, but it comes with a mat, which is really good. And then now they just came out with the... I don't even remember what it's called. But it's a bit more... it's almost like... it's all white and purple in coloration. It almost reminds me of like a sci-fi hospital. But it's basically the exact same terrain, just different colors. And it also comes with a mat. So now I have 2 mats that are 3 feet by 2 feet. So it's a 4 foot by 2 foot board I have, I think. I don't know if that sounds right. No, that would be a 4 foot by 3 foot. Maybe that's closer to what it is. I don't remember. It's not regulation size yet, but it's better, and it can, so I got a bunch of terrain, so it's starting to look a bit more representable, but it's still not good, because what you want for a game like Infinity, for the terrain, for the board, whatever, what you want is basically something akin to Titanfall. You want something like Titanfall's Angel City map, where there's just buildings everywhere, you can climb up them, you know, there's ramps and ledges and all that kind of stuff. There's a street, but, you know, there's buildings everywhere, because Infinity is literally Titanfall meets XCOM, the tabletop game. That's what it is, and that excites the hell out of me. It's so damn cool. Played through a bunch of scenarios just on my own. I can't wait to actually play it with somebody, but damn is it cool. I don't know what I'm gonna really do for terrain. It's expensive to get quality constructed, pre-painted terrain that actually looks good. It's expensive to fill up a board. I mean, to fill up a whole table, if you buy it all at once as part of like a pack, you're looking at $500 pretty easily. And that's a lot of money. That's a lot of money. So if you're really into like, if you're really into modeling and things like that, you can build your own. And I could do that. I have a lot of cardboard lying around. I got plenty of glue. I'm sure I could make my own terrain. But it wouldn't look very good. And the painting really just kicks my ass. So I wish I had somebody that was just so into it. You know, would just make a, fill the entire table with all sorts of terrain. And if you look up pictures online of just wargaming or infinity tables, there's some insane nonsense out there, man. Because it's not just, people don't just do like cities. They'll do like the jungle. Like a jungle outpost and things like that. They'll do anything, anything you can come up with. Take any map from Titanfall. And boom, you can convert it into a table for infinity. And it's so cool. I've talked about X-Wing in the past. And I said I liked X-Wing, and I do. But terrain between X-Wing and Infinity is just a world of like, it's a completely different experience. Terrain in X-Wing is basically just asteroids. And you just, you don't want to fly into an asteroid because it can fuck up your ship. And asteroids block line of fire. And that's it. In Infinity, though, terrain is just everything. It's insane. Because, yeah, I mean, it blocks the line of fire, sure, but the things that you can do and maneuver with terrain and how it influences, you know, trajectories and objectives, like, it's just, it's crazy. It's crazy. So, having what I have on my table, which is basically just a bunch of shipping containers and rectangular buildings of the same height, with a couple of wooden towers now, it's not... I don't think it's fully representative, the Infinity experience. If I had, like, silos and ramps and walkways and all this shit, it'd be some next-level stuff. But, alas, it is what it is. It's still very cool either way, so I'm gonna plan an Infinity night with Ziggy and get him into the game. Yeah. I don't think I have quite enough miniatures yet for a full, like, 300-point tournament-ready army. But, I'm getting there. It's just so insane. At this point, I basically just have the Operation Ice Storm, and then I have two extra minis. One for Nomads, one for Pan-Oceania. Some of the other factions are just crazy, though. There's one faction that's all kind of like Scottish Highlanders. I don't know if the whole faction's like that, but a good chunk of them are Scottish Highlanders that just use kind of swords and stuff. There's one that's like, there's aliens. You can get like an alien one that's like shapeshifters or some nonsense. And then there's like the combined army, which is sort of a mishmash that just looks fucking cool as hell. I gotta get that next. Yeah, there's a lot of cool stuff. But mine are all unpainted and it bums me out. Anyways. Oh, we are shifting D&D, by the way, to Sundays instead of Mondays. Because Mert did not appear for last week's game. So we just nixed him completely, instantly. One strike, you're out. And we're bringing in Charlie Chuck. So that'll be good. Even if it's just the three of us, we'll probably still have a good time. Yeah. Jesus. Alright, so on Thursday, of course, we went to our Club B's, as we do. Place was bumping. And I actually got there late. And I see my friends sitting at this table that is not acceptable. It's kind of like a bitch table. It's where they put you when they don't like you. It's very cramped and uncomfortable. And so I'm like, this is not we're not sitting here. It's not happening. So we asked to be moved. And we get moved over into my favorite waitresses section. So I'm like, okay, this is much better. And she was pretty cool. She's the one that shares my hatred for Jeff. Although apparently that has now waned. She no longer really hates him. She said some shit about him in the past, if you remember. But now she said, oh, I don't mind Jeff. He grows on you. And I'm like, yes, like cancer. And I think she laughed, so maybe it was like, I don't know if it was like a ha-ha laugh, or it was like, you're planning on tipping me, so I'll laugh. I don't know which one it was. But no, she's pretty cool. She got us, I don't know if I talked about this, but they discontinued the sliders that we used to always get. And so now we get mini cheeseburgers off the kids' menu, which is the exact same thing, but Jeff doesn't like it because it's against corporate policy, of course. So, I had asked if Jeff was there tonight, and she said no, and I'm like, oh, so mini cheeseburgers then? And she's like, yeah, I said next time I would get them for you, so. So we all ordered that. That was good. And then it was my buddy's birthday Saturday. So we asked if he could get his birthday drink on Thursday. And I don't know how many waiters or waitresses would ever allow that, but she did. So she got him a birthday drink, which is cool. And so then she was cleaning a table right behind us. It was later in the night. And I was like, I need to test the waters. You know, I need to find out some info about this chick. I need to get some intel. You don't want to just go in blind into a situation, you know. So I wanted to do some recon. So I asked, I was like, can I ask you a question? She's like, sure. And so I asked her, I basically told her about when I went to the Cheesecake Factory for my Tinder date. And I asked her what it meant when a girl said that she didn't feel a spark. The look on her face after I asked the question, I guess I would describe as, I wouldn't say nervous. I mean, that's kind of ridiculous. It wasn't nervous. Maybe anxious. Maybe uncomfortable. It's hard to say. I didn't think it was an unreasonable question. Although, perhaps the subtleties were not lost on her of why I was asking the question. It was very random. It's not like I discussed this with her previously. It just came out of the blue. So perhaps she's smarter than I give her credit. That's kind of mean. I apologize. And so she tried to answer the question, but I don't think she really knew the answer. Because nobody knows the answer to that bullshit. But she was very surprised that I had taken a girl to the Cheesecake Factory on a first date. She was very impressed with that. And so then I said, you know what it probably was? It was probably that she smoked weed and I didn't, and she didn't like that. And she said, Really? That's surprising. My boyfriend's a stoner, and we get along just fine. And I'm fairly certain that she said this. I mean, yeah, contextually, it was kind of part of the conversation, sure. But I feel like she said it to kind of gauge my reaction. So touche, because I failed. I did classic male maneuver, of which I kind of averted my gaze right after she said the word boyfriend. Which if you're looking for that is very telltale. I mean, you'll know immediately. And then I think I also like dropped the tone of my voice just a slight bit in almost disapproval. You know, just like, oh, okay. It wasn't quite as chipper as it was 10 seconds ago. So I failed that test, if that's what she was watching for. And so after that, the conversation just kind of ended. I was turned slightly towards her, and I think I turned slightly towards my friends a little bit. So that was another kind of sign. It just kind of ended. So, well done, if that's what she was setting out to do, which she probably was. She added that, oh, we get along just fine. I bet you do. But I don't know. If you're looking for a guy that's not a stoner, now you know one. Yeah, so that was Thursday night. Friday night, we went to a bar, our usual bar, or as I like to call it, the white supremacist capital of Wisconsin. Because I have never once seen an ethnic person in that establishment, ever. Except for the Mexicans that work in the kitchen. That's it. I don't know if that counts. And so I arrive a little late again. And I walk in there and I see a couple of my friends sitting there with a member of the female persuasion. One that I recognize. This girl I've talked about previously. I think her nickname was the Huntress, if that's what we had. That's what we discussed. Unless you're Olaf and you called her Artemis, but that just weirds me out. I don't support that at all. Vote no on that. And so her and I have some history. We got some beef. But apparently that's all resolved. And so she's like, hey! And I'm like, hey. And then she laughed and she's like, I can't wait to see how many more awkward hellos I get. This girl, you know, never. I haven't seen her in like over a year. And so I sit next to her, because why not? And, this girl is really damn annoying. This girl just never shuts her mouth. I think she has a problem. And she's just ditzy as hell. Like, she doesn't understand how time zones work. She just doesn't get the concept that television shows air at the same time. But because of time zones, it's like different times for people. She just doesn't get it. And this girl, I used to be absolutely smitten with. And I never realized how damn annoying she is. But now my eyes have been opened. And I understand. But it also worries me. Because they say that every man grows up to marry his own mother. And my mother never knows when to shut the hell up and is ditzy as hell. So it worries me a little bit. that either, you know, this is the type of girl I'll end up with. But I guess it worked out for my parents. So, yeah, like, she is just, I mean, don't get me wrong, she's nice. I mean, she's not a bitch most of the time. And, she's very outgoing, obviously. And she's kind of spunky, I guess. Which isn't a word people use anymore. I like to use that word, but she's got spunk. She's got spunk all up in her personality. And what did I want to say? She was very friendly towards me. And she was like showing me her tattoos on, like, her upper thigh. Which wasn't really, she was wearing short shorts, so it wasn't, like, a big stretch. But it was just like, okay, how long am I going to look at your inner thigh? yeah. Should I look away now? And, at one point, her chair was, like, on my chair. My stool. And I actually had to push her away. Like, no. No! So, I don't know. She's the, she's the type of girl that says YOLO unsarcastically. If you need more description. And she said it many times. She's also the type of girl that uses the word besties. Also unsarcastically. But she's also kind of, you know, she's like the life of the party. Whether you want her to be or not. She's providing all the energy of the entire thing. And, what else? I thought becoming a mother would, like, mature you up a little bit. Like, you'd stop saying YOLO, at least. But no, it doesn't mature you at all. She's also the type of girl that has apparently had about 5 soulmates in her life, and not one of them has ever worked out. She just kept on, she was telling us about her new soulmate, who she hasn't gone on a date yet, and who still has a girlfriend. And I just wanted to be like, you keep using that word. I don't think it means what you think it means. I'm not the type of guy that believes in that nonsense anyways. But, yeah. Last time I met her, she was telling me that she didn't ever need a man in her life because she was going to be just a great mother to her child and she didn't need a father to help her. But now, she believes this guy she's never gone out with and is currently dating someone is her soulmate. So, yeah. This is the type of girl I'm describing. But as I said, she's not like a bitch, so she's got that going for her. She did smoke like 4 cigarettes while we were there, though. But what single mom doesn't? Am I right? I don't know. She also, every time that I see her, well, I guess the last few times I've seen her, she always brings up the fact that to like other people that didn't know us or haven't met her, the fact that her and I used to really duke it out. And I feel that's really unrepresentative of what happened. It's not, we didn't duke it out. And she was like, yeah, he really used to be an asshole. And I'm like, hey, you weren't exactly a peach. I think she kind of just puts it all on me. But she admitted that she wasn't very good. So at least she can admit that. She's matured a tiny bit. So Studs has a new girl he met on Tinder, and she showed up to the bar. And so he's very nervous about it because my obligation when people bring a new girl into the things is to put her through the fire and flames. I have to grill her extensively, like a cop, find out everything I can about her. And that ranges in questions. It starts off pretty innocuous. It starts off with, you know, how do you feel about Dwayne The Rock Johnson? And if they don't like The Rock, then that's a very bad sign. This girl loved The Rock. Big fan, so that's a good start. Then we move on to, like, you know, who's your favorite superhero? And not once have I ever had anyone answer The Flash, by the way. This girl said she doesn't give a shit about superheroes, which is not the right answer ever. And so Studs was like, you were supposed to answer The Flash. And then, you know, the girl next to me, like, she says, who gives a fuck about The Flash? I feel like she said that just to piss me off. I don't know if she really knew. I don't know. I feel like she had to have known. Who doesn't know I love the freaking Flash? I've made that very well known. But I just looked at her and I'm like, this is probably why I lost interest in you. So the questions went on. I mean, this girl handled it pretty well. But she handled it almost defensively, I would say. Like, there's a word for how she responded. Her reaction, I guess. I think she tried to act tough, I guess. There's probably a word for that. Like, she kept on being like, oh, these are your questions? Like, come on. These D-minus for your question-asking skills. And like, alright. I'm like, I'm not... I mean, I could say things that would make you leave. Do not doubt me. Do not doubt my words. But I'm not going to do that. We're having a good time. You know, I asked her stance on tattoos, how many she had, piercings, her stance on abortion. You know, just basic things like that. And I asked her if she played D&D. She said, fuck no. I'm like, okay. I assume you don't play Call of Cthulhu then. And of course, I mean, the girl next to me, the Huntress... Like, literally, I couldn't get more than one question without her interjecting with her thoughts and her own questions. Like, she just never shut up. And so she says then, oh, don't play D&D with him. He's terrible at it. Now, I don't take offense at much in life. I really don't. But You're not gonna insult my RPG abilities. I take pride in very few things. One of them is how I play RPGs. I mean, yes, I may have kind of an alpha male thing going on with that. I may take charge when I shouldn't. But I've got some skills. Not to brag, but I can hold my own. This girl played D&D with us twice, and all she did was, like, steal some rags, like, steal, like, an ogre's loincloth or something like that, and her scheme was to put it on my character's face. That was her plan. That's how she played. And you're gonna sit there and tell me I'm terrible? That's some Gary level shit you're pulling. Not that I said any of that. I don't even remember what I said, but it probably wasn't nice. Because that was out of line. That was out of line. That would be like me responding with, "Well, you're a terrible mother." That's what it would be like. Yeah. Then I asked her, this girl that, you know, Studs met, whatever, she apparently has a degree in history. She got her degree in history about 7 years ago. She currently works at Costco, which, based on my understanding of history degrees, is about right for the average. Just playing if you have a history degree. Unless... Never mind. I'm sorry. And so I asked her... She has a degree in American history, so I'm like, okay. So I asked her if she thought America was justified in dropping the nuclear bomb on Japan. Which isn't really a hot button issue. I mean, most people are gonna think we were justified. Jesus Christ. So I wasn't really expecting her to argue. So then I asked, a bit more of an interesting topic, if she thought that Japan was justified in bombing Pearl Harbor. And I thought with a history degree, American history, that would be kind of her bread and butter. She would know all the facts on that. Most Americans think that Japan were evil, horrible bastards that just were sitting on their thumbs and were like, let's bomb the shit out of an American naval base. Which wasn't really the situation. It was a bit more complicated than that. So her and I actually got into a rather loud debate about the bombing of Pearl Harbor in the white supremacist bar capital of Wisconsin. And I know some stuff about history. Like I said, history is not my forte. I don't have a great deal of interest in it, but it's okay. So I know some shit about Japan and some oil sanctions and, you know, China and blah, blah, blah. The rest of it was kind of bullshitting, just to see what she caught up on, how good of a history degree she had. I feel like I won the argument. I feel like she backed down, which I did not expect at all. She just kind of gave up, and I was like, okay, and we moved on. And so that's the power of speaking with confidence. It doesn't matter whether you know you're right, you know you're wrong, the other person knows you're right, any people listening know you're right, or it doesn't matter. Just speak with absolute confidence. And that's what I do. So I don't know. I don't know if Japan was actually justified. I think so. But she did not offer a compelling argument otherwise. So that was good. I don't know, maybe she's just a bit rusty. Who's to say? Anyways. So that was kind of our Friday night. Saturday, we had a cookout for my friend's birthday. And of course, now the Huntress showed up. She's just going to show up to all of our events now. She seemed a bit more mellow this time because I think she got like 2 hours of sleep and she worked that day. And she was hungover, so she wasn't quite as talkative, which was good. And, not really much to say about that cookout, actually. It wasn't very eventful. We had actually probably the largest group we've had in a while there. It was a big deal. Numbers started to dwindle down, though. I had brought a bunch of kind of party games. I brought Spyfall. I was really hoping to bust that out. I brought Pit, of course, and Say Anything, stuff like that. So I was hoping to bust some things out, but numbers just kind of dwindled, and towards the end of a night, after all that, people just don't want to do anything, so didn't get to play anything. And, it's like, it was around 12:40 or something like that. We decided to go to Applebee's so that my buddy could get another birthday drink. A second Applebee's free birthday drink. And so we took along our crazy Russian friend who happened to be there. And our waiter at Applebee's looked like he came straight out of like a 70s basketball movie. Like he was like a black 6'8" guy. And he brought us 4 waters, which they never do at Applebee's, by the way. This is probably the first time we've ever gotten water there. He brought 4 waters and he carried them, 4 glasses in one hand. And he just kind of plucked him out of his with his other hand. And he was like, "Here's your water." It was insane. His hands were gigantic. So that was interesting. But there was a waitress. My God, those waitresses. Ridiculous. This girl was like 5'1". Curly hair. She wasn't our waitress. But, like, the place, this was at, like, 2 a.m. or something. Like, the place was closed, pretty much. Like, if you walked in, they would not serve you. And everybody was kind of cleaning up and stuff like that. So this waitress was kind of just, like, loitering around our table. She was not our waitress. She was loitering. She decides to kind of like count her tips for the night at the table 2 feet from us, like across the tiny little hallway, the aisle. The entire place is pretty much empty. And she picks the one table right next to us. I should have taken this as some sort of sign for one of us, but I didn't. Actually, I'd noticed it, but I didn't do anything. And then she started cleaning like all the tables right next to us. And she was like, she like took off her little apron and she was like stretching constantly. It was nuts, man. She was putting on a show. I'm not even making this up. It sounds like I am, but I'm not. And yeah, you know, we caught eyes. Eyes were caught. But it was like 2:30 and I was damn tired. Not gonna be making moves. No, it's just a no-go. And then also, like, she was, like, standing right next... I don't know what she was doing. She was standing, like, right next to us. With, like, her phone. I don't know what she was doing. And we were talking about something, and Studs was, like, somewhat loudly, he was like, "Well, you know, I don't believe in God anymore." And I was watching her, because that's what I... whatever. So. And she looks right at him as he says, right after he says that. He looks right at him and just frowns. Like, just a very visible frown. And so, of course, I noticed that, and I told him after she walked away. And he's like, damn, I was hoping to get with that. I'm like, nope, you blew your chance, man. You can't just throw shit out like that. So we all left and nothing happened. Story of my life. Yeah, that's pretty much it. Just a whole bunch of uneventful nonsense. But that's the life of Mangg. Yeah. So maybe we'll have some more Huntress stories in the future. I doubt it. I really doubt she's going to rejoin the group or anything like that. She's a single mom that works at like 5 in the morning. She does not go out much. But I don't know. There's going to be a role manging video tonight. Probably her story tomorrow, Duelist Tuesday, and then we'll see where we go from there. Yeah. So my name is Mangg. This has been Hanging with Mangg. I'll see you fine folks next week.